The Canadian Rockies by Rail is funded in part by AAA Western and Central New York. AAA is a not-for-profit member service organization providing members with travel, insurance, financial, and automotive services through its local branch offices, AAA.com, and the AAA mobile app.
Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome aboard the Rocky Mountaineer.
The window of a train is one of the best ways to enjoy the beauty of North America. The Rocky Mountaineer offers train trips to Canadian cities, mountain towns, and national parks. Our journey begins with the 157-mile passage from Seattle, Washington to Vancouver, British Columbia.
There's so much going on in Seattle. You get the energy of Seattle as you're leaving, right into the beautiful Puget Sound. Go along the coastline, make our way in through some beautiful agricultural lands, and make our way in through the border, and right into Vancouver.
So what we like to do is to start this trip off on a good track is a little cheers. To friends, to new friends we'll make, to amazing journey. Cheers and welcome aboard, everyone.
To take full advantage of the scenery, the Rocky Mountaineer travels only during the daytime. Passengers overnight at locations along the route. This trip covers roughly 1,200 miles on the train through some of the most remarkable scenery in North America. From Vancouver, the train overnights in Kamloops and then onto Banff. Most passengers explore the Canadian Rockies before reconnecting with the train in Jasper for the return trip to Vancouver.
Which would you prefer?
The drive-through.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We're here to encourage friendships and socialization. There's not much to do but sit back, relax, as we bring you in along the beautiful coast into a place I love to call home, Vancouver.
The Canadian government began operating daylight train trips through the Canadian Rockies in the 1980s. The service was eventually turned over to the private sector, and the Rocky Mountaineer has been operating tours along the historic and scenic rail lines of the Canadian Rockies for more than 25 years.
We talk about the four S's. So they come out expecting the first S, which is the scenery. Then they know about the food. We call it the savory and the sweet, and creating great regionally focused meals focused on the Pacific Northwest and Western Canada. The service is the third S. And then the last one, I think a lot of people don't realize that occurs on a train, is the socialization. There's a real magic that happens when you're traveling with people from around the world. You know, the conversations you strike up and the friendships that are kindled on a train, it's really special.
When we finish this tour, we're flying down to Austin, so I'll see my granddaughter for the first time.
Oh, for the first time. How exciting. Yeah.
Well, it's a different pace. The train is a social environment. When you get on the train, you dine together, you chat together, you see the scenes together, and it becomes a very social and a very pleasant, relaxed environment. And then this particular route we're traveling is all about the scenery. It's going to be spectacular the whole way.
Probably the most stunning area will be Chuckanut Bay, renowned for having the Cascade Mountain Range actually goes right down into the ocean, and you'll see these beautiful sort of volcanic rock formations.
After Chuckanut Bay, the train hugs the water's edge and crosses into Canada.
In typical Rocky Mountaineer style and Canadian fashion, we'll be playing the national anthem. And feel free to wave your flags.
Now we can drop the puck and play some hockey.
railroads are almost as important as hockey in Canada. The completion of Canada's first transcontinental railroad in 1885 united the country from coast to coast. The railway also opened the Canadian Rockies to visitors.
What's unique about Western Canada is it was the railway that actually worked and determined the locations of many of our towns and cities. Vancouver was incorporated in 1886. The very first transcontinental train arrived in Vancouver, and of course, the rest is history.
Vancouver is a cosmopolitan city, blessed by its geographic setting. It is a stunning mix of mountains, forests, and water. The area's natural resources are what attracted the first European explorers in the late 1700s.
Lumber is what really made the place. It's what put the place on the map. And so that's how this place was known. You fast forward now into 1871, the Crown Colony of British Columbia joins the Canadian Confederation. 1886, we're incorporated as a city. 1887, the train rolls into the new city of Vancouver. I think the geography does make it unique. It's quite spectacular. And so you spend a lot of time outside when you're in Vancouver.
We absolutely have everything. We have glorious mountains, we have beautiful river systems, and of course we have the Salish Sea. You can live in a richer place.
Aboriginal people have lived in the Vancouver area for more than 8,000 years.
I find that in the Vancouver area, Aboriginal culture is very present and strong. You have some of the richest, diverse First Nation cultures in the world. This is a very rich city, and Aboriginal people are a big part of its growth and development. What exists today in Vancouver is a really good partnership between the local city and the First Nations people. There is representation of Coast Salish culture. You see Aboriginal sculpture throughout the city.
While Vancouver has grown to become Canada's third largest city, it remains a city of neighborhoods.
We're standing right in the middle of Gastown, one of Vancouver's two historic districts. We're just steps away from the historic Maple Tree Square, which was really where the non-native settlement of this area began. Gastown is sort of all the elements you want in a sort of a really neat, interesting, dare we say, funky neighborhood. Probably the most photographed object would be our Gastown steam clock. It taps into the city's downtown steam system, powering the steam whistles on top of the clock, which then do the Westminster chime. So it's one of the really key icons of Gastown.
Stanley Park is one of North America's largest urban parks. It symbolizes Vancouver's unique marriage of natural and urban space.
It is a really great space on the edge of the city. You can walk off the trail and boom, you're out into a forest.
Stanley Park is one of the most significant places for Coast Salish peoples. It is the homeland of three distinct nations, the Squamish people, the Musqueam people, and the Tsleil-Waututh people. So we all have a really rich connection to Stanley Park itself.
The 1,000-acre park is almost entirely surrounded by water. A 14-mile seawall is the world's longest uninterrupted waterfront walkway.
And it is now the best walking, bike route, roller skating, all those things. And it is just one of the really great public spaces within Vancouver. You have this great city, you have this great natural surrounding, and you can be urban and you can be out in nature all at the same time.
Vancouver's scenic beauty is increasingly matched by a growing reputation as a food and wine destination. Most Vancouver food adventures begin with a water taxi ride to the Granville Island Public Market, located on a small island in the heart of downtown.
It's incredible. That city has changed so much. I mean, only about 25 years ago, that bridge was wood.
I used to be the chef in that big glass building over there.
Really?
Yeah. J.P. Guerin is the executive chef on the Rocky Mountaineer.
On the train, it's more like approaching to what you would do in a first-class restaurant.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
This is Granville Island Public Market. It's actually the oldest public market in the Vancouver area. That's a beautiful fish.
Yeah, he's a beauty. He's just caught locally.
Look at this.
35 pounds, all like that, eh?
Wow.
Yeah.
Leading around water, as you can see. You know, seafood is a very big part of what we do in our cuisine. During the growing season, we have absolutely beautiful vegetables, beautiful fruits. That's nice.
Good morning. Can I get those raspberry? Looks pretty good. Can I get this one?
Okay. Yes. You.
I like to come there because it's the varieties and the quality of the produce and the seafood that you can buy there. It's absolutely incredible.
And I'm gonna have some blueberries as well. They look absolutely gorgeous. Yes, one box of blueberries.
We are blessed. We have incredible product and produce to offer to the world.
These are the best.
Fingerlings. We'll have some for tomorrow. It's just a showcase of what we actually buy for our train, for our guests.
Are you guys going to be riding on the train tomorrow?
Yeah.
Well, you know, very happy that you're going to be able to join us.
Yeah, well, we know what we're going to be eating now.
Good.
Here we are.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everybody. We've got a big train, a huge train this morning.
The day begins early for the culinary staff on the Rocky Mountaineer.
In each dome, you guys identify exactly who you have. Check with your host team.
Each carriage has a dedicated culinary team that prepares and serves all meals on board.
Make sure you guys taste the food. You have to taste your food. You guys are chefs to cook, and it has to be seasoned properly. And otherwise, I think we're gonna have a wonderful day. Off you go to the Rockies.
Good morning once again, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Rocky Mountaineer. We're about to begin boarding for this morning's train departure.
The Rocky Mountaineer is a reminder of an age when train travel was a glamorous adventure. Passengers will spend a full day riding the rails through the historic and scenic landscape. This leg of the journey toward the Canadian Rockies is a 260-mile passage from Vancouver to Kamloops. Crossing the Fraser River, the rail line transitions from metropolitan Vancouver into the countryside of British Columbia.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome on board the Rocky Mountaineer as we make our way from Vancouver into the wonderful town of Kamloops.
The highlight of that first day is leaving the city life behind. We start to enter the gentle, rolling farmland, and then we enter the Fraser Canyon. And you start to see scenery that is a bit more treacherous. You're perched up on a cliff edge, and you see a raging torrent down below.
The train follows the historic rail route that connected British Columbia to the rest of Canada over 130 years ago.
It is the original route. It has not changed. There's been minor changes here and there as you're up in the Rockies, but the original route down the Fraser Canyon is that one that was built in the 1880s.
We're going to make our way past some spectacular scenery and some incredible sights. The Fraser River will follow for half of our journey, and it is the longest river here in British Columbia.
The Fraser River dominates the landscape with spectacular canyons and unspoiled scenery. The river and its tributaries are world-renowned for salmon fishing. One of the highlights is Hell's Gate, where canyon walls rise 1,000 feet above the narrowest part of the Fraser River. The rapids and steep gorges were major impediments to the construction of the railroad.
The railway construction in the east started the earliest back in the 1870s. And the construction of the railway really was at its peak from 1881 through to 1887 on the original transcontinental mainline. The most spectacular and most difficult part of the construction was actually on the western end, and that was through the canyons of the Fraser and Thompson River. And as you travel this route today and go up the Fraser Canyon, it'll be very, very evident to you the challenges of building the railway through the west.
When it was completed in 1885, the railroad was considered a great engineering feat. More importantly, it unified the nation.
Historically, the creation of Western Canada really is due directly to the railways. And the reason that British Columbia became a province of Canada was a promise by the federal government that they would connect it with a railway to the rest of the country. So it really was the way our country was opened up and the way our goods moved.
Today, the Rocky Mountaineer has a different purpose, to provide a unique platform to explore the natural beauty of the Western Canadian landscape.
So now we're going to clean up some salmon. We got that beautiful salmon we got yesterday. That's a beautiful piece of salmon.
The culinary part of the train experience is as important as the scenery.
On Rocky Mountaineer, you will see that you spend 25 to 30% of your time sitting down and enjoying your breakfast and lunch. So it's a very big part of your day.
Let's just saute the onions. When we do the salmon, we'll just, you know, serve the salmon roasted in the oven with the glaze and some green onions and some fresh vegetables.
We're making sure that we feature the cuisines of the region. We want people to come on and have a fantastic culinary experience. So it's a big part of the journey. I think it's safe to say nobody ever gets off the train hungry.
Ready to go? So now it's time for lunch.
So today our appetizer, we have roasted root vegetable soup and a very nice golden bean salad with mixed greens, red pepper, and a balsamic dressing.
The orders from the guests are coming in. Everything is cooked to order. Fingerling potatoes. They're not quite done yet. They need to go back in.
Chefs must prepare exceptional food in a tiny space while on a moving train.
We have to prepare food for 70 guests, and this is literally our entire cooking area. You know, it's literally about five and a half feet maybe. So we'll just get a bit of butter, a bit of olive oil, and we're gonna add some fresh young carrots. Just saute them, a little salt and pepper. Beautiful. We're probably right now traveling at about 40, 50 miles an hour. Everything is moving. That's why we have those hand guards here on the stove. So sometimes, you know, frying pans would actually move forward or backward towards us. So we have all these guards to make sure that doesn't happen. We cook the meat in wine and onions and garlic. It's really, really a nice dish. What we call really the definition of comfort food. You know, a lot of our guests really love this. It's very Canadian as well. We still have to produce the type of food or quality of food that you'd expect in a five-star restaurant, right?
The best burger in the world.
The philosophy we have on Rocky Mountaineer is very simple. Do not prepare food for our guests or our staff that you wouldn't eat yourself. And that's the philosophy.
You're sitting across the table, maybe from guests that you haven't met from before, or if traveling together with friends that you may have had for lifelong friends and enjoying amazing food while you watch the world go by.
After a day traveling through British Columbia, guests overnight in Kamloops. The city of around 100,000 is located at the confluence of the North and South Thompson Rivers. Kamloops is known as Canada's tournament capital, hosting up to 100 sporting events each year. Kamloops is also one of Canada's newest winemaking regions.
So I'm just taking a sample of our Cabernet Merlot, which is one of many wines that we do here at Monte Creek Ranch. Most of our fruit is from our own vineyards. We've got 65 acres in the ground.
The Monte Creek Ranch Winery emphasizes the region's history and natural resources.
Kamloops is in the Thompson Valley. It's a stunning destination, lots of natural, rugged beauty, lots of wildlife. Known largely for agriculture and livestock, there's a big farm-to-table movement. We really wanted to embrace the frontiersmen, the prospectors, the early settlers in this region.
The signature wines are named for Billy Miner, an outlaw who robbed his last train in 1906 near the site of the winery.
The historians that write about Billy Miner often classify him as the gentleman bandit or gentleman train robber and go as far as to say that he coined the phrase, put your hands up, sort of a nice guy when he robs you, if you will. The Hands Up White and Hands Up Red blends are definitely the engine behind our brand.
We do a range of varieties. The region is really going to succeed with varieties like Riesling, Pinot Noir, Chardonnay.
British Columbia as a whole is quite a new wine producing region, quickly gaining traction and accolades throughout the world. It started in the Okanagan Valley, and now the Thompson region is quickly gaining a lot of press and a lot of tremendous wines.
Welcome back on board the train, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you had a fine evening in Kamloops. Today we are going to be on our way towards Banff. So yesterday was all about the canyons. Today is going to be all about the mountain ranges. We also see seven different river systems today, and we'll give you a prize if you can name all seven at the end of the day. So we're going to have another great day in store on our way towards Banff. But welcome back on board the train, ladies and gentlemen.
The 310-mile trip from Kamloops to Banff weaves past glacier-fed rivers and lakes and climbs steadily toward the snow-capped peaks and magnificent scenery of the Canadian Rockies.
We're coming up to a major highlight of the trip. So the Stony Creek Bridge is the longest bridge over our two-day journey. It is 380 feet long. We're going to be 275 feet above a creek bed. You will see a creek flowing into a bit of a waterfall. Have your cameras out for this one.
It's building that anticipation. We start to gain an elevation. The forest creeps back in again, and you're climbing up, heading towards the Rockies. So a lot of anticipation to what's to come.
Well, it's non-stop scenery end to end with the rushing water, the rock walls, and all of that. And then we'll pass through some lake country, and then you'll get into the rugged peaks of the Rockies.
So we are coming by the beautiful Kicking Horse River here. Absolutely a stunning river with that aquamarine and blue color in it. So we kind of twist and turn through the Kicking Horse Canyon here, where we see the river on both sides of us, creating some incredible photo opportunities as we go by.
At Craigellachie, the last spike was driven on November 7, 1885, completing Canada's first transcontinental railway. The completion of the Canadian Pacific Railway was one of the largest and most difficult rail projects undertaken at the time.
The most spectacular and most difficult part of the construction was actually on the western end. The easy part was from the east and across the prairies till you got to the mountains. And once you left Calgary heading west, you had four different mountain ranges to cross. The railway had to build through those. A whole lot of blasting, digging, carving a shelf out of rock. The company imported a lot of Chinese laborers over to the west end, and they built much of the western end of the railway. Great sacrifices in life as it was being built, accidents, blasting, rock falls, all the things that you could imagine would happen.
So we are coming up to one of our highlights of the day, and that is the spiral tunnels here.
One of the most dangerous sections on the original route was an 8-mile stretch known as the Big Hill. It was replaced in 1907 by a safer way through the mountains known as the spiral tunnels. Construction of the maze of tunnels through two mountains required 1,000 men and 20 months to complete.
It was absolutely incredible feat of engineering when it was completed, because working towards each other, the crews met with an error of less than 5 centimeters, or less than 2 inches. So absolutely incredible feat.
Exiting the spiral tunnels, the train is engulfed in the Canadian Rockies, revealing some of the most remote and beautiful Canadian landscapes that can be seen from a train.
One of the things that's unique about the Canadian Rockies is the ruggedness of the peaks. There'll be snow-capped, beautiful vistas, wide-open landscapes. It's quite awesome.
From the beginning, the builders of the Canadian Pacific Railway envisioned the train as a way for visitors to discover the Canadian Rockies. CPR General Manager William Van Horn was quoted as saying, "If we can't export the scenery, we'll import the tourists." To accommodate visitors to the rugged wilderness, the railroad built a series of European-style hotels along the rail line.
It was a way of getting people to the west, and that was where they built the big lodges. So this became a way for tourists to come and see a part of the land, but it also became a way for the railway to do business. They're spectacular buildings of their own right architecturally, and they're still huge draws. So they're fabulous places to visit, fabulous places to stay, and quite an experience.
As the railroad hotels became popular tourist destinations, small mountain towns like Banff began to appear in the Canadian Rockies.
As we approach Banff, the forestry really changes. You have noble fir and grand fir and blue spruce and all these perfect Christmas trees. You've got the glacial runoff coming down into the water, these turquoise colors, contrasting with the greens, majestic mountains. Quite a broad valley as we come into Banff. So just glorious mountains on both sides. It's a real sense of fulfillment and accomplishment coming into Banff on the train.
I hope you enjoy the Rocky Mountains, and I hope we've shown you this little piece of Canada, because we're very proud of it. So we are approaching our destination of Banff, where everybody will be getting off today. Now, if you are staying in Banff for a few days, it's a beautiful area. It's a small little mountain town. Make sure you take a walk around.
Banff is the starting point for exploring the Canadian Rockies by car or bus. It is a quintessential mountain resort community. Surrounded by wilderness, the downtown core has an abundance of shops, hotels, galleries, pubs, and restaurants.
It gets busy in the summertime, but it's a time where you can base yourself in terms of accommodations. And from here, it's an excellent base to travel and do many things within a 60-mile radius.
Retired Mountie Pat Kamenka serves as an ambassador for Banff and the Canadian Rockies.
This is the dress uniform of the Mounties. It is not a practical uniform for policing. You can't run in the boots. These pants slow you down in spandex, and his hat will blow off in the wind. But it's one of the uniforms that people recognize us for, and this is really the old Mounted Police and what people want to see.
Banff is another Canadian destination blessed by its geography. Situated in a broad valley along the Bow River, rugged wilderness literally pushes to the edges of town.
It is a beautiful area. Nice recreation on the rivers, good fishing. Most of the mountains here have got really good trails that you can hike. There's horseback riding. There's wildlife you can see all over the place. So if you're interested in wildlife, we have it. climbing mountains, we have it. Sitting down in the pub and having a pizza, we have that too.
From the start, Banff was a railroad town and tourist destination. In 1883, three railroad workers discovered a natural hot springs in the area. The Canadian government and the railroad developed the springs as a tourist attraction. The builder of the Canadian Pacific Railway, William Van Horn, decided it was the ideal location for the Banff Springs Hotel.
He realized from feedback that many people wanted to spend time in the area. So he formed ideas of building chalets and hotels along the railroad.
Thank you.
All right, have a good day.
I think they realized this would be a good opportunity, rather than just people just whipping through on the train, for people to stop and enjoy the view.
Van Horn built the hotel at what he called the Million Dollar View.
We're looking at the Million Dollar View, and it's just interesting to see when people walk out and you get that, wow, and they're just looking around with their mouths open. And I don't think anybody would argue with that price tag.
The original wooden hotel of 250 rooms opened in 1888. The current Fairmont Banff Springs Hotel is a mostly stone structure with more than 700 rooms.
Many people, I think, can imagine what it would have been like back in the time. We occasionally see people having a little dance, you know, as if they were doing some ballroom dancing from back in the old days.
Four national parks, Banff, Jasper, Kootenai, and Yoho, form the core of the Canadian Rocky Mountains and make up one of the largest protected areas in North America.
Canada has the oldest national park system in the world. It's a pretty vast system, and our goal is to have protected regions that represent all the different ecosystems around the entire country. Well, the visitor experience in the Canadian Rockies is kind of that quintessential wilderness, mountainous Rockies, because the national parks here were formed actually to attract tourism because it was a pretty lonely place. At one time, Banff National Park, Jasper National Parks were these little dots of civilization in this vast wilderness. But now, they're the wilderness in all this civilization.
One of those dots of civilization is majestic Lake Louise. The lake is bordered by the natural wonder of Victoria Glacier and the man-made Chateau Lake Louise, another of the historic railroad hotels.
Well, welcome to my little piece of paradise, you folks. Thank you for joining us in Canada's oldest national park. There's probably not anything, I think, more Canadian than a canoe. We probably think of Lake Louise as probably maybe the second most photographed landscape in Canada. Second only to maybe think of that big waterfall in Ontario called Niagara. So the chateau, even when it first started taking guests in 1894, was always built on the theme for the outdoor adventure or the alpinist. And we still hold that theme true today.
The original Swiss Alps-style chalet was destroyed by fire in 1924, replaced by the architectural gem that hugs the shore of Lake Louise.
And to paddle one of Canada's most beautiful lakes here with people from around the world, we're trying to educate people about what a special place this is, and they will help us look after it in Canada's oldest national park. I've been here for 30 years. It still exceeds my expectation. It's like looking at a picture, and you look at that picture, but then when you get here and actually are on the shores here, the picture doesn't do it justice.
While the railroad first opened this area to visitors, the Canadian government recognized the need to accommodate tourists arriving by car.
Well, the Icefields Parkway is one of the most beautiful drives in the world. It was actually designed to be a tourism route and a connection between Banff and Jasper National Park.
The Icefields Parkway is a 143-mile-long, two-lane road that allows visitors to literally drive through the Canadian Rockies. Completed in 1940, it is named for the many glaciers along the route. The Icefields Parkway allows visitors a closeness to mountain scenery, glaciers, and waterfalls that reach to the edge of the roadway.
It's got lots of spectacular views. It takes people into the heart of the mountain wilderness with just these spectacular vistas, and the lakes and the rivers are just surreal. The colors are unbelievable.
Bow Lake is one of the largest lakes in Banff National Park. The glacier and waterfall that feed into the lake are the source of the Bow River that flows through to Banff.
The Icefields Parkway is awesome. It's the quintessential wilderness. Sometimes it's just surreal because the sun is sparkling over this snow and these glaciers. And it's so pristine. It is just, it's awe-inspiring.
The Columbia Ice Field is visible from the parkway. It is a remnant of the ice mass that once covered most of the area. Athabasca is one of several glaciers that flow from the immense ice field.
Welcome to the Athabasca Glacier. We are going to be passing below Mount Athabasca. It is the tallest mountain surrounding the Athabasca Glacier.
Athabasca is the most visited glacier in North America. Visitors get onto the glacier in specially designed oversized vehicles.
And you guys are in luck. There is a big herd of bighorn sheep around the corner, so just get your cameras ready. So you have a bunch of female sheep with their newly born babies. They like to lick the salt off the rocks here.
So we're standing on the Athabasca Glacier right now, which is fed by the Columbia Icefield. The Columbia Icefield is at the top of the third step up here, and it feeds down much like a large lake feeding into a river. The Athabasca Glacier dates back 11,000 years to the last ice age. This entire area is glacier carved, and at one point would have been completely covered by the ice field.
And that glacier really tells us the story of climate change because it has receded so much over the past 100 years. I think it makes it more real for people. When you're out there and you experience it yourself, you can look and say, it's moved. And that's really telling for people.
The glacial water that our guests do taste, it is 100% natural and it is 100% safe to drink. We have some people who try just one glassful, some people who bring up a 5-liter or to collect and take home with them. We say around here that it's what keeps us so good looking and young. This is a bucket list item. So it really is amazing to see the reaction of guests when they get out here. They are amazed by the vast size of the glacier and the mountain surrounding.
The Icefields Parkway crosses from Banff National Park into Jasper National Park. A popular stop is Athabasca Falls, where the river squeezes through a narrow gorge.
That is a great, great scenic spot. There's some small trails you can take, but it's really scenic. It's thunderous falls going over the rock and the mist rising. So it's a great photo op.
The Icefields Parkway ends at Jasper, Banff's northern counterpart. Another turn of the century railroad and resort town, Jasper is even more laid back than Banff.
Population's only about 5,000 people, and they take great pride in not having a lot of chain restaurants. It's very authentic in the experience that people will have. It's not a typical resort-type town because of that history as a railway town.
In 1923, the Canadian government took over several failing rail lines and formed Canada's second transcontinental railroad. The town and national park were already established when the rail line was completed.
The town of Jasper started out serving the railway, and then it became the headquarters for the park. All those things, the parks, the railway, were all kind of tied together, and it was for economy, it was for the government to draw people west and increase tourism here.
Like Banff and Lake Louise, a lodge soon followed the rail line.
The Fairmont Jasper Park Lodge started out as Tent City, and it wasn't actually owned by the railway until into the 1920s. It really brought a different class of tourists, people who didn't want to stay in the tents. They wanted something a little bit nicer.
The Jasper Park Lodge differs from the massive structures at Banff and Lake Louise. Cedar chalets and log cabins border Lac Beauvert on more than 900 acres within the national park.
These lodges are not only a part of the history of the railway, they're part of the history of the parks and how we've developed a relationship with the visitors to these places. Because some of these lodges have generation after generation coming back, getting their picture taken in the same place and enjoying some of the same trails, and that's the wonder of it.
A surprising attraction at Jasper Park Lodge is one of the most scenic golf courses in North America.
We are situated in the mountains. It's one of those golf courses you always remember. Every single hole out here has a 360-degree scenic view.
The course was designed in 1925 by Stanley Thompson, Canada's premier golf course architect.
Hole 14 is our signature hole. I like to call it the selfie hole. All of the groups that come to the tee box, everyone wants to take a picture of themselves. You can almost see a mountain view from any single point on the golf course, and that's one of the characteristics of Jasper.
At 2.7 million acres, Jasper National Park is the largest park in the Canadian Rockies. 97% of the park is protected wilderness.
The wilderness is just spectacular. We kind of call it the gentle giant, because one of the things that people will notice compared to Banff or compared to these other parks, it's kind of more open. So we have all the big, we call them the charismatic megafauna. We've got the bears, we've got the elk, the moose, the deer, the cougars, the coyotes, the wolf packs. It is a wild place.
Having spent several days exploring the Canadian Rockies, our journey returns to the train for a final passage through the unspoiled wilderness of the Canadian landscape.
The railway actually cuts through places where most people don't get to see. They're very remote, and you will see wildlife, you'll see vistas that others don't see, so that's very beautiful.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome aboard the Rocky Mountaineer. I trust that everyone had a wonderful stay in Jasper over the last few days. My name is Darren, and I'm going to be with you over the next 2 days as we head down from Jasper into the city of Kamloops, and then from Kamloops into the wonderful city of Vancouver.
The final onboard journey takes 2 days to cover the 500 miles from Jasper to Vancouver, with a final overnight stop in Kamloops.
You're going to see lots of changes in scenery over the next 2 days as we depart from the beautiful and majestic Rocky Mountains onto the semi-arid desert region of British Columbia and then into the temperate rainforest of the Pacific Northwest. So get your cameras out. There's going to be a lot of great sights coming up in the next few miles.
The first part of the route continues through the Canadian Rockies, passing some areas virtually inaccessible except by rail. Many remote communities owe their very existence to the railroad. In some cases, there are more people riding on the train than living in the towns along the route. This is an area full of mountain peaks and sparkling lakes. Yellowhead Lake stretches out from the tracks, with majestic Mount Fitzwilliam and Mount Rockingham serving as backdrops.
It really feels like the mountains are just right on top of you. And you really feel very connected to the outside world. You really get to go through some very pristine parts of the wilderness that the highway does not go through. You really see a part of the country that you can't really see anywhere else.
So now we're passing by the second lake of the day, and it's actually one of my favorite on the trip, and that's Moose Lake. And it gets that name for the large population of moose that are known to be active in the area. So please, ladies and gentlemen, enjoy Moose Lake.
Having spent days gazing at one beautiful mountain after another, it is difficult to imagine the most magnificent mountain of the journey lies ahead.
So the spectacular Mount Robson is just coming into view.
At 12,972 feet, Mount Robson is the highest peak in the Canadian Rockies. The rail line provides one of the best ways to view the sheer sides and snow-capped crown of one of the most prominent mountains in North America.
We're exceptionally lucky today to be able to see the top of Mount Robson because it is actually so high that it has its own weather system. And it is often masked by alpine clouds that cover the top half of the mountain. Take as many photos as you can of the spectacular Mount Robson because it's actually only visible on average about 12 days of the year. Very lucky indeed as we make our way past Mount Robson.
The tracks meander through the Canadian wilderness, past spots known as Little Hell's Gate and Pyramid Falls, capturing views that will remain memories for a lifetime.
The magical combination of making friends with strangers, finding peace and quiet and refuge from the modern world on a slow-moving luxury train through the beautiful scenery. Quite often, I guess, are very surprised at how much the community they form with the friends they have around them on their seats. That's a real ingredient to that experience, is the bonds that the guests form amongst each other, too.
You really get a special view from the train. The rail lines travel through a lot of spots where they were the first ones to come through. You've got large segments of the track that run right alongside these rivers and lakes. You don't get that traveling any other way. To travel through the Rockies and see some of those sheer cliffs and the faces of those mountains in the train, it's a wonderful way to see that. We like to talk about trying to create life-changing experiences. We try and do everything we can to get there.
Our trip on board the Rocky Mountaineer has been about the journey, with the windows of the train revealing the majesty and mystery of the Canadian Rockies.
The Canadian Rockies by Rail is funded in part by AAA Western and Central New York. AAA is a not-for-profit member service organization providing members with travel, insurance, financial, and automotive services through its local branch offices, AAA.com, and the AAA mobile app.